So I have this new thing that's been on my desk for a couple days, and I want to talk about it. This is a Lenovo ThinkPad USB travel keyboard. And obviously, I'm not using it as a travel keyboard. I'm actually just using it as my main keyboard. These things are actually sort of hard to find. I look them up on eBay and stuff like that. You can get one for $80 or something like that. Amazon didn't even have this model. The specific model is where is it? SK8848. 45CR. Now, how did I get this thing? Now, firstly, you know, if you watch this channel, I hate mice. I do not use a mouse. It is so annoying to have to go over when you're getting something done to use a mouse. It's so not, it's like a superpower having a TrackPoint because you could type and use the mouse at the same time. It's crazy. So the keyboard that I've used for, a year or two maybe, is this thing here? It's the Endura Pro, the Unicomp Endura Pro. I very much like this thing. It's an old buckling spring keyboard. I did a review on it. It has a couple drawbacks. It doesn't have a middle mouse button, and there are a couple things that aren't perfect. But I love this thing, and I've used it for a long time. When I did a video on this, a subscriber emailed me and said, "Hey, I have one of these things. It's on my shelf. It's not doing anything, and I can't get it to work with Windows. So could you use it?" And I was like, sure, I'll take it. Absolutely. Thank you." So thank you, Richard in the UK, for sending this in. So I've been playing with this for a couple days. And first off, of course, it didn't work on Windows. You couldn't get the drivers for it or something like that. But people always say about Linux, "Well, Linux sucks because it doesn't have drivers." Correct. Linux does not have drivers because you just plug things in and they work. That's how it works. Okay, anything USB is just gonna magically work on Linux. That's how, it's monolithic kernel, kids. That's the benefits of it. So I plugged this thing in, works very great. A couple things about its build. I'll go ahead and say it feels very sturdy. That's hard to communicate just with the picture, but I'll tell you, it feels sturdy. But it also feels like way lighter than you think it's gonna be. Okay, this thing's very skinny. It definitely weighs less than this book. All right, it's not heavy. I mean, it truly is a travel keyboard. Okay, so let's look at the back of it. You'll notice it does have these little stands here, so you can have it flat if you prefer that. You can have the smaller stands. I like the big ones. Okay, I like it at a nice angle when I'm typing. That's what I prefer. Notice also it has this. This is a very nice thing. I feel like this is very nice that they squeezed this in. But the ability to take the cord and sort of wrap it up if you really want to travel with it works pretty well. Just to be able to, I hate it when I'm going through a bag and there's just like cords all over the place. This is just a very nice alternative. And I will note that the cord is very long. Like I have sat here, put my feet up and stuff like that, and I'll work, not being pretty far from my computer. And it's a great thing not only to be able to use your keyboard far away, but also this little TrackPoint. Okay, excuse me, Corona. So notice also this palm rest is very big. It might be confusing. There are actually more modern versions of them. I think if you go looking, I think there are like versions. Well, this is all going to be only this model. But there are other travel keyboards, Lenovo travel keyboards, that have less of a palm rest. I really like the big palm rest because it puts your hands at an angle when you're doing this stuff, and I don't know, I very prefer it. So here, no, look at this keyboard. Okay, is there something missing? Do you post it in the comments if you don't see what it is. It's for the algorithm, kids. No. Okay, what's the thing you don't see? You don't see Windows keys. No Windows keys. So when I first saw that, I was like, "Oh shoot, that's a big problem." Okay, because I use, my setup. I have everything configured to some kind of shortcut key. Nearly all of them involve holding down Windows and pressing one of these buttons. Like every single button when you hold down Windows is mapped to some kind of shortcut on my computer, because that's how I roll. It's a great life to live. All right. So I need a Windows key. Thankfully, I actually don't need a Windows key, and that's because of this thing here, caps lock. So a while ago, since I'm a Vim user, I switch escape and caps lock because it's nice having escape down here. So this usually functions as an escape. But there's also a little program on Linux that I've used for a long time called Xscape, and you can tell it, "All right, make it so." Basically, what you can tell it to do is, if you just press this key, it functions as escape. But if you hold it down and press something else, okay, so I just held that down and pressed D, And that brings up my D menu prompt. Okay, I can get rid of that, bring it up again. Okay, so I don't need a Windows key. I can actually just hold down Caps Lock and do any of the shortcuts that I otherwise do. Okay, you know, get rid of the borders and, you know, stuff like that. All right. Or toggle the borders. So that's actually not a big problem at all. So it's just, you know, new getting used to this one keyboard. There's another thing I have. This is my keyboard mapping file, this little script that runs on startup. This other thing I have here actually detects to see, I'm doing a screencast without screencasting from my screen in this video. You'll notice that I actually have this thing detect whether it's this keyboard is attached. And then it runs these two commands. What are these two commands? Well, I realized that although everything works on this, there are a couple things, there are a couple default settings I don't like specifically the middle mouse. The middle mouse button works. It pastes stuff in or clicks on stuff. But really the default functionality on a ThinkPad is you hold it down and you can hold it down and then move the track point, and that's scrolling. Okay, so you can scroll up and down. All right. By default, that is not how this works. It doesn't do that. So these lines at the end basically say, all right, so activate that feature. That's all that is. There's probably some way to have it permanent, like set it permanently in your system configuration, but I didn't bother to look it up. Either way, this way works. I'll also say that the mouse moves a little bit slow. I feel like it's a little bit, so here's me moving around nearly at top speed on this keyboard. Whereas here's me moving around on top speed with my desktop or my laptop key mouse or whatever. I think I just said the wrong word, who cares? So I feel like this mouse is a lot faster than this one. So it's a little different, but it's not been a big problem. I just sort of get over it. Now the only problem, real problem I can say with this keyboard, and it's not like a deal breaker for me, is if I'm using Caps Lock as super, which again is a pretty rarefied thing to do, but if I have a keyboard shortcut that has both Caps Lock and Shift, sometimes the third key I press won't go through. It's a key rollover problem. That's a problem you often have on keyboards. Now I can just use right shift and Caps Lock and it'll work, but it's just a couple keys. Like for example, if I hold down, you know, normally if I hold down Shift and Caps Lock and I press 2, that moves the window to the second workspace, but that actually doesn't go through here, so you got to use Right Shift or something like that. You know, just little things like that. None of it is a big problem, so I can't really fault it for this. I'll also say one key, this little key up here, this mystery key. Here's the interesting thing. I haven't seen this before, let me go over. I have an instance of Zev pulled up, and this little Zev, what Zev is, it monitors key presses and stuff. So if I move, let's say I press some keys, it's gonna tell you like what keys were pressed and stuff like that. Here's the interesting thing. All these keys, like you press the volume keys on this thing, all right, it'll show you, it'll generate whatever is being pressed, okay? I gotta move my mouse over. So it'll show you whatever is getting pressed, okay? But if I press this mysterious settings key, nothing actually happens. So this key is actually not, I guess this is something where, you know, Linux doesn't automatically detect this key, which is weird because it detects all these other ones. But so I'm not quite sure about that. But in general, that's pretty much it. I really like this thing. I don't want to say I'm still going to be using this, but I'm using this more and more. I don't know, maybe I will. Here's the other thing. Okay, look at this. Lenovo. It looks like I'm a fanboy. I'm basically an Apple. I'm like the anti-Apple user because these are like the most anti-Apple products in the entire world. Although I'll also say my screen, and those of you who know, that was actually a gift from a subscriber as well. So, wow, look at that. I'm like, it's just my subscribers use Lenovo. I really like this thing. I think you should check it out. Obviously, they look pretty rare. It seems like $80 seems pretty pricey, frankly, for like a teeny tiny keyboard. I think it was, you know, this one's closer to 100. I sort of like, well, I don't know. I'm divided. You make your call if you want to buy something like this, but just know that it's out there if you're looking for some kind of keyboard that doesn't require mouse. I haven't really taken this around that much. Obviously the little key, the thing on the back makes that easier, but honestly this might function as a good desktop equivalent. Like I I don't know, it's pretty seamless. Either way, I want to see, I think there was some other joke that I was going to make. I totally forgot about it. Dang. Well, anyway, I'm just chilling with my Lenovo stuff, so I'll see you guys next time.